The Transcona Foundation failure baffled engineers for more than 40 years. Prior to construction, the soil had been successfully tested with nearly twice the weight under which it collapsed. Even after the failure, the investigation confirmed that the design assumptions were correct. Everything indicated that the underlying soil should be able to comfortably bear the structure at 100% grain capacity. Furthermore, similar structures in the area existed for many years with no foundation problems at all. What could have possibly gone wrong here? The failure remained a mystery for another 40 years. In meanwhile, new soil mechanics theories were developed, and finally, in 1951, a new investigation was launched which explained what had gone wrong. In this video, we will dive deeper into foundation design principles and explain them intuitively with a simple experimental model. By the end of the video, you will be able to explain the critical design considerations of foundations and why this grain elevator failed, something that the engineers could not do only a century ago. Let us first start with some basics. Shallow foundations transmit the applied structural loads to the near surface soils. The main goal of a foundation is to safely distribute the loads from the structure into the ground. The word distribute is key because in almost all cases, the gravity loads coming down the columns would punch right through the soil unless they are properly distributed over a larger area. This is exactly what the foundation does. A foundation spreads an otherwise concentrated force onto a larger area. In doing so, the foundation induces compressive and shearing stresses in the underlying soil. During the late 19th and early 20th century, engineers realized that foundation design could be based on the contact pressure between the footing and the underlying soil. This is exactly what was done at the Transcona site. When the excavation reached its design depth of 3.7 meters, field-bearing capacity tests were carried out. A field-bearing test consists of loading a plate of predetermined area until the soil under it starts to excessively settle or heave around the plate. Several tests were performed at the foundation level, and all of them carried a pressure of at least 400 kPa. This means that a plate of 1 meter squared could carry more than 40,000 kilos before the soil begins to fail. With this knowledge, the bin house was designed to occupy an area of 23.5 by 59.5 meters, where a total of 65 grain bins were placed on top. At full capacity, the structure, together with the grain, was designed to weigh around 42,500 tons, which meant the distributed pressure to the ground would be around 300 kPa, well below the 400 kPa failure load repeatedly obtained from the plate loadings. In reality, the structure failed at 87.5% grain capacity with an estimated bearing failure pressure of 296 kilopascals, an error of more than 25%. To be able to understand what went wrong, we need to understand what happens under the plate as it's being loaded. The vertical stress radiates under the foundation, with the load decreasing in value as it goes deeper. This makes sense since, as the load travels deeper into the ground, it is carried by a larger area. This vertical stress pushes the soil grains down, which want to relieve the pressure by displacing to the side. This mechanism creates shearing stresses, which, as you know from the previous videos in this series, are the reason why soils fail. This theory was developed decades before the failure at Transcona. What was not known was the bearing failure mechanism, which was first explained by Terzaghi in 1943, 30 years after this failure. Terzaghi realized then when the soil slips, it does so at an angle which depends on the friction angle of the soil. The soil near the corners of the foundation is subjected to the highest shearing stress and fails first. The displaced soil from under the foundation has to find itself an exit, causing a ground heave in the vicinity of the structure. The movement of the soil causes a slip plane to occur, whose geometry depends on the properties of the soil and the size of the foundation. This failure mechanism is well illustrated with a simple model. The straws in this case represent soil particles that get interlocked to form a block of soil. Representing the soil particles as long tubes helps us achieve a plane strain condition, which in simple terms means we can look at the soil in 2D. In reality, all failures are three-dimensional, but engineers often analyze them in a simplified manner that allows 2D simplifications. Notice how, as the bottle is being filled, or the structure being constructed, the added weight causes the particles to start rearranging. At a particular point, when the weight of the structure exceeds the friction force between the particles, or in this case the straws, a slip plane forms starting from the corner of the foundation, exactly like Terzaghi predicted. Another important observation, in line with Terzaghi's theory, is the triangular soil block that is formed under the foundation and displaces the rest of the soil, causing soil bulging on the surface of the terrain. When it comes to soils, there is always a factor of uncertainty. This means that it's nearly impossible to replicate the same failure twice. The slipping always happens at the line of least resistance, which is different for every experiment and doesn't follow a nice curved trajectory. In fact, the failure plane predicted by Terzaghi is very theoretical and rarely achieved, but it is a good approximation of the overall failure mechanism. Now, with the slipping plane defined, Terzaghi calculated the forces needed to overcome the resistance of the soil at the slipping plane, which gave the bearing strength of the soil. These forces are the interlocking of the particles and the stickiness or cohesion of the soil. Notice that the length of the slip plane depends on the size of the foundation. Or in other words, larger foundations scoop out more soil underneath them, resulting in a longer failure plane, and therefore higher resistance of the soil. Bearing the foundation further extends the slip plane and provides confining pressure to the soil under and near the foundation that makes heaving out much more difficult. This is the main reason why foundations are often built below surface level. Another failure mechanism that often governs foundation design is settlement. Settlement is arguably a much more problematic issue, which is often the reason why we use deep foundations, such as piles. Let us know in the comments if you know of any popular settlement failures, and we might do a similar video on that case. With this new knowledge of bearing capacity, let's have a second look at the Transcona failure. When the engineers performed the bearing capacity tests, they used plates of around 30 to 60 centimeters in diameter. Based on the Terzaghi failure model, this meant that they were only testing the soils near the surface of the plate. The actual foundation was 23.5 meters long, which meant the failure line would go much, much deeper. To make this scenario even more unfortunate, a separate boring investigation was launched in 1951, which found that at around 7.5 meters below the foundation, a weaker clay layer existed, with half of the shear strength of the upper layer. In terms of its color, grain distribution, and mineralogical content, the weaker clay looked almost indistinguishable from the stronger upper layer. The wash borings from 1913 provided only a visual assessment, which misled the designers into thinking that the underlying soil is homogeneous. Based on the stress contours we saw earlier, the induced stress from the full-scale foundation would have induced significant stresses in the weaker clay. These stresses manifested in consolidation of the lower clay layer, which resulted in an initial settlement and the full bearing failure shortly after. Looking at the bearing failure plane, it is clear that a significant length of this plane is within the weaker layer, which had poor shear resistance. In comparison, the plate loading did not come even close to loading this layer, which gave a false sense of reliability and strength. It may be unfair to blame this failure on lack of knowledge, because if the site investigation had been properly conducted and the weak layer identified, the engineers may have included an additional safety factor that would have prevented this failure. Within days from the failure, the bins were hauled at the bottom and the thousands of tons of grain were safely extracted out. Within 12 months from the failure, the bin house was back into an upright position. The running of the bin house itself is an amazing engineering feat, which we will have to leave for another video. The Transcona Grain Elevator continued to provide relief for the Winnipeg yards during the months of peak grain shipment for more than 100 years, until it was decommissioned in 2021. If you enjoyed this video and you would like to see more videos like this, consider supporting our channel by buying us a coffee on the link in the description. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.